I was born, you see, in Indianapolis, Indiana, so I'm a Hoosier. My mother was an opera singer and very well known throughout the country at the time. My father was a dentist, internationally known for his contributions to dentistry. And it was a great time for me as a boy growing up because nothing was too good for Howard House because I was a spoiled brat. I remember back as a young lad that I knew I was going someplace. I just wasn't quite sure how to get there, but I grew more confident in time and decided I would be a doctor. The first year at USC was pretty tough because I joined a fraternity and again with my banjo and I played tennis for them. They put me on probation because my grade point average at the end of that first year was a 1.8. So I couldn't play tennis any longer, so I dropped out of school and went to Whittier College where I could play tennis. But my grades were again pretty bad. So I went to see the dean at the end of the third year at USC Medical School.
I told him I was interested in going to medicine. He said, "You're not serious, doctor." The dean asked me, "Are you kind of, you date a lot?" And I said, "Yes, I enjoy dates." He said, "Maybe you better slow up on that a little bit too." But he told me that if I worked hard and came back the next year with better grades, he'd have a place for me.
So I dropped everything, and I mean everything. I had tutors around the clock, practically, on endless subjects.
So I entered medical school thanks to Dr. Dean McKibben, wonderful man, with a 2.15.
That meant my dear wife in Whittier College. And I'll never forget it because he could not have been a more wonderful wife or mother than my wife was. Full of encouragement, full of humor, full of a lot of fun. She took care of those children like you wouldn't believe, working as I did day and night. And I must tell you that not many women would put up with Howard House.
When I finished my residency at USC, my father provided me the opportunity of visiting many prominent specialists throughout this country and abroad.
And probably it was the most valuable year and a half I've ever spent in my life. When I came back from Europe, I'd seen so many things and came back with this new operation, the fenestration operation. And my practice just boomed because I was the only one that had the ability to do this operation. Now, I only charged $500 for each operation. And if they didn't have it, it was $400, $300, $200, $100, nothing. Still operating on them. It's too important to turn away anybody for a dollar to get their hearing back. We had all these patients coming through. So one of them happened to be by the name of George Eccles from Salt Lake City. Went home hearing, throwing away his hearing aid. So he called a friend of his, Gene Witter, who was a Dean Witter brokerage firm, and said, get your daughter right away down to see Howard House. She goes to the hospital, operate, go back to San Francisco hearing. Thrilled to death. Witter sent down $10,000. And George Eccles matched it. So $20,000 in 1945 was a lot of money, you see. And so the Institute first started with just a little desk and a half-time secretary.
And to see where it's grown today, the world's largest center for the care of patients with ear problems, seems unbelievable to me. As a matter of fact, I just have to pinch myself to even believe it's true.
Well, as I look back, part of my life, of course, my baby has been two
Good
things.
Good job. Give me five.
The care of patients.
Good job.
And the things we've been able to do with the Institute in the way of research. I've always felt that the closer the clinicians could work with the research people, the sooner the answers are going to get as to why did this do this or why did this do that. And it's worked beautifully. But I've always felt that it doesn't do any good to do all this research unless you teach. So we've always had an open book.
All of my students now far outperform my ability, and that is a real satisfaction. You know, you played just a little part in that.
So It's nice to know you've touched the life of those people.
I remember when the whole family went to Sweden to be with Dad when he received his honorary doctorate degree at Karolinska Institute, which is a very, very high honor and really kind of the scientific medical counterpart to the Nobel Prize. It's a very formal function, and so he had to rent a white tie outfit.
And I didn't have time to try it on. I realized it was too big. We didn't have a safety pin. And so walking down, we did this fine. Then when they called me up to get the stand, I was in a cold sweat. And then he gives me a ring from my finger. So I come over here like this and put the ring out and get the finger, because I did have to grab the diploma in one hand. So I changed my, and then I have to shake hands. So I had to get my over here and shake hands, right, and walk back down the steps.
I've been asked, what it is that drives me? I don't feel I've been driven. It just kind of came natural. I have a lot of energy. I love the work I'm doing. It gets pleasure. It's joy to help people. And all my people that I had working with me in those days, they weren't employees. They were associates as far as I was concerned. Believe me, they never worked for me. They worked with me. So the preacher's bright, very, very bright, and it's going to be wonderful.